Okay, so consider this problem, okay? Now, the, I assure you that studying F1 is enough to understand the trouble, okay? And then I quickly mention the work of Kolmogorov. After Kolmogorov was also Arnold. Arnold produced his work when he was 22, I guess. I guess your age, maybe you are older than you. You are still late for. It's a bit depressing, you see, the age of this person when they produce this masterpiece. Okay. Okay, so now consider the most clement situation. Like, let me assume that analytic. It's analytic, so admit M. Where M is an integer, M is a vector with M1, M2, Mn. So, and each of these are integer, okay? And so this is a Fourier series in on the angle, and I assume that this direct system go to zero. Exponentially fast, so very clement assumption. Okay, and then I write the same. I try to look this in the same form. Let me use the same. Theta, and I put this here, and I try to and I compute this. I have to compute this quantity. And okay, this is simple. So I have to add this. So I have H0 F1. This is the derivative H0 respect to theta n F1 respect to I n minus the H1. This is zero. This is zero. This is omega. Okay, this is omega. And so I have that, let me put here a minus in such a way. I have this one. So the minus, I have this. And so I have sum of omega n I. And here I have this. So I use this formula. So I am sum on M. When I perform the derivative is only here. The derivative, I have M N. You see? I M N. And then I have F 1. Okay, this is the Poisson bracket. Then I have to repeat the same with the other term, and then compare the so let me consider the case where F0 is a certain action. So I have the minus the derivative of F0. The sum on n, derivative of F0 respect to theta n, derivative of this respect to I n, plus the sum of n f zero respect to I n. This is zero. This is zero. This term is zero. This term is zero. This is the delta. This is the delta. This is the delta, because this is so this is delta J n. And here, what I have here, it's the same computation before. Here I have sum of m. When I derive this, I have h1 m I a I m theta, and the derivative I have an I m derivative I m j. Okay, so I have to compare this with this. So I have an equation for f1. Okay, I hope that everything is correct. But so what is the important things is this part. Okay, this part. So I have to compare this and what I have. So apparently I have the solution, because I have f1 m I equal to what? Equal h1 m I. And okay, we have some decoration, this stuff, some decoration is not important. What important is that I have to divide by this term. This is the important term. Here is sum on n omega n I m n. Okay, this is the important stuff. So, and apparently I solved the problem. Okay, this is the problem of the small denominator. So you have this thing, so you know this, you know this, you know this, so apparently you solved the problem. But now you have to be sure that this is possible to do. There are two possibilities, that omega is rational, the frequency are rational among them, or are irrational. Or if are rational, there is a problem. Okay, but you can say, okay, rational is a rare number, no? The mathematicians say, rational, who cares, rational? No. Rational are small, are poor, or say, rare, in the sense of Lebesgue measure, no? So, yeah, the situation omega, the omega rational, no. Okay, but this you can decide that you don't consider the case with the rational omega, okay? So the omega are irrational. So if are irrational, apparently you are happy, because this is for sure different from zero. Okay? It's true that it's different from zero, but can be arbitrarily small, because there are, no, because, but you have that this is difference of zero, but arbitrary small. So you can have some combination of m such that this can be arbitrary small. And this is the end of the story. This is the end of the story. This approach cannot work, because you have formally the solution, but the solution is meaningless, because this can be arbitrary large, at least for certain m and certain region of the phase space. Okay, this is called a small denominator problem. So small denominator because there is this denominator which not can be small, but is small, for sure is small. There is some, for some value this is small, and this is the end of the story. Okay, so apparently this is a terrible new. Huh? It's a terrible new for all the people working in celestial mechanics. But apparently it's a wonderful new for us. For us means people work in statistical mechanics, because in statistical mechanics it's a wonderful result, because there is apparently a very, very positive consequence in statistical mechanics. Why? Because if you have a conservation law, for sure the system is not ergodic. This is clear. Now, here you have not a conservation law, but is it, the result is the good direction, no? That maybe you can expect that since you have no conservation law, then the system is ergodic, is what you can hope. This idea is tempting. Even a genius like Enrico Fermi arrived to this wrong conclusion. Even Enrico Fermi arrived to the wrong conclusion, which actually is wrong, and is wrong for a very subtle reason. And the person who realized, so you see that this result for the people working in celestial mechanics is very negative. For people working in statistical mechanics, apparently is positive. The situation is in between. Is in between, the sense that the result is not so negative for the celestial mechanics, but is not so positive for statistical mechanics. So at the end, both the community complain. Come si dice in Italia, mal comune mezzo gaudio. Come si dice in inglese? Fuori d'Italia. Okay, so now the rest of the story, okay. Kolmogorov. Kolmogorov, this result was in blatant contrast with the fact that the people working in celestial mechanics perform in a naive way the perturbative computation, and with also rather good result. But apparently this result of Poincaré saying, no, this is forbidden. In principle, this is forbidden. But using this formal method of the expert of celestial mechanics, the results are not so bad. And the reason that is not so bad has been understood by Kolmogorov. The reason is the following, that this result, the statement is that doesn't exist a conservation law in the full phase space, but it's not clear if it's possible to have a sort of local existence in the phase space. The idea is the following. You see that this thing is okay apart in the region where this is small. So you say, if I remove the region where this is small, maybe I can go on. It's not a joke to do this, because you have to remove the part, and you have to be sure that the part you remove is not the whole space. Okay, so this is the idea of Kolmogorov. Kolmogorov was able to prove the following. Kolmogorov and then Arnold and Moser. Okay, the following result. So you have H zero I plus epsilon A one. Is one. Okay, there is some hypothesis. For example, you have the hypothesis if you have the omega, you have the omega, which are given by this stuff, and you have the matrix the determinant of this A must be different from zero, and then you have some regularity on this. You have the following result, that for small, okay, so if epsilon equals zero, you have the tori. So the tori means I n equal constant and theta n t equal 0 plus omega n t. Okay, so you have the motion evolved on this tori, like in donuts. Okay? When epsilon is small, according to Poincaré, these tori are destroyed, right? But are destroyed generically. But the fact that in a region, let me call, I don't know, omega epsilon, the region omega epsilon, one has in order epsilon deformation of the tori for epsilon equals zero. Okay, so it means that you imagine that you have this tori, this is where epsilon equals zero, then when you introduce epsilon, instead to have this, you have something like that. But this not everywhere, in a certain region. Okay? Then the non-trivial part of the work is that the measure of this region go to one when epsilon go to zero. This is a non-trivial part. This is a non-trivial part. In the sense that so this means that there are always some situation where this is not true, but there are a lot part of the phase space where this is true. So this is this Hamiltonian system. With Hamiltonian system, you have that. Okay, you have this Hamiltonian system. You see, this is the integral part. You have just two oscillators, and then you have a non-integral part in some cubic stuff. And so, according to you study this with the Poincaré map. I guess Fabio introduced the Poincaré map. And so with the Poincaré map, you understand if the system is regular or not. Okay. So for example, this is here. This depends on the energy. Okay. This is if the energy is small, then you have that the perturbation is small. So you have that in the grid part of the phase space, you have a regular behavior. This curve. You see, these are the intersection of the. So you have this sort of tube, then you cut. And you observe this, okay? This means that you are looking, these are the survived tori. But there are some regions where this is not true. You see, you have this unique trajectory. This is a chaotic region. So you have that, 99% of the region is regular, but there are, 1-2% which is chaotic, okay? Then, of course, this depends of the epsilon. So, in fact, if you increase epsilon, so you have that still remain some region, but now are not so big. So, if you increase again energy, you have that. So, almost the full space is chaotic, but remain still something. So, you see that. From the statistical mechanics point of view, these are disturbing behavior. You don't want this, okay? Why for people working in other field, don't want this, okay? So this is the story. So you see that at the variance with the dissipative system, in the dissipative system you have a sort of a transition chaos, not in the Lorentz system. So up to a certain control parameter value, the system is somehow trivial, and then after this critical value, you have a chaos. In Hamiltonian system, it's different. In Hamiltonian system, you have no critical value of epsilon. This means that what happened? Increasing immediately, the system is non-integrable immediately, and if epsilon is small, you have that only in small region, you see the trouble. This is the difference. So, the fact that in this case you have no attractor. This means that your result depends on the point where you start. This is not true in dissipative system. In dissipative system, you start from any point after a certain transient, you approach to an attractor. Here is different. So this is is really a big difference between dynamic dissipative and Hamiltonian system. In fact, the two communities are more or less split. So there are the people who are expert in Hamiltonian system, people who are expert in dissipative system. Okay, now, but let me explain you that the Hamiltonian system, usually the Hamiltonian system, the first thing you have a system with the bolts, with springs, and these things. You know? Yeah, this is true. But there are very nice application of Hamiltonian system in a different context. For example, in fluid dynamics. Let me explain why. So imagine that you want to follow a Lagrangian particle in a fluid. So you have a fluid. You have a fluid with a certain velocity field. Okay. Let me consider the case in 2D. Okay. And incompressible fluid. Oh, since it's compressible, this means that you have two components, but you have a constraint, this constraint. And so you understand that in some sense the two components cannot be independent, okay? And so one possibility is just to use one of the components, but for tradition, the people introduce what is called the string function. Such that so U1 is equal to U2 is equal to minus. So you see that this is automatically this is true. Okay, so this is a way to remove one of the two components. Instead to decide to use U1 or U2, you use another quantity, this string function. Okay, this is the elementary remark. Now consider the following problem. Consider the problem that you put dust in your field, and you want to follow this dust. Okay, and this dust must be small enough in such a way you don't perturb the field, okay. But not too small, otherwise you feel the Brownian motion. Okay. And this is what happened in the experiment in geophysics. The people put the balloons in atmosphere or the what is this? Come si chiama le boy? Le boy, come si chiama le boy?
Boys.
Boys, the boys in the ocean. And they follow, so you study this equation. Okay, this is the equation of the dust, a small dust in the fluid. You have to follow, are affected by the fluid. And because of this, so this means that we have x dot equal u1, y dot equal u2, but this is the derivative of this, and this is minus the derivative of this. So, So you remember that if you have Q dot equal derivative of H respect to P, and P dot equal minus derivative respect to Q. You have the same structure. So you have the same structure. Instead to have Q, P, and H, you have X, Y, and Z. Okay? So you have, usually we consider the case where H is autonomous. But now we allow the H to be time dependent. Okay? It's not forbidden. Okay. And why? Because it's the unique interest situation. Because in the case Psi is autonomous, the system is integrable. The system is integrable because Psi is conserved. Okay? So now you have that we want to study this problem with C equal a part which is stationary and a part which is time dependent, in particular periodic in time. This, for example, when you imagine that you want to study the dust, how evolve, so for example, contaminant, you have a contaminant, you have the velocity, your velocity field which change in time, and you want to understand how all this contaminant. Okay, this problem, this problem is called a system with the 1 degree of freedom and half. Why? Because one, because it's one dimension, but then half because there is also the time. And this is the first non-trivial problem you can try to understand in a Hamiltonian system. Why? And because in order to understand the problem, you can reformulate the problem in terms of symplectic maps. And for example, you can instead to look at X continuous time. See, if this is periodic with period, let me call T, I can define, let me find X, N, and Y, N, like this at X at time NT. And of course, I can write these two terms as a function. No, let me call this gamma n. So I have that gamma n plus 1 must be a certain function of gamma n. Of course, because the system is deterministic, and I look at any period. So this is, since the starting problem is Hamiltonian, this problem must be symplectic. So you have a conservation of the area, okay? So the fact that you have this, let me put here also epsilon. Okay, when epsilon equals zero, you have a conservative system, you have an integrable system. Then when epsilon is different from zero, you have a non-integrable system, and you want to understand how this behaves. Okay? This is, at theoretical level, is the simplest non-trivial question you can wonder. Okay? Even this has been studied by Poincaré, always Poincaré. Okay? And he introduced the idea of, which is extremely important and powerful, the idea of homoclinic intersection. I don't want to discuss in detail because I have no time, but just to give you what means. So imagine, but it's necessary to pass, technically, to pass for the, imagine that you have the pendulum, just the pendulum. You have the pendulum, you have p squared over 2, minus cosine of P. Okay, you have something like that. And so, forget the constant. So you have something like that. So this is the potential. Okay. This is the potential. This is the potential. So you see that if you are at this energy, you have a periodic motion. So you have oscillation.
So cosine of Q, right?
Huh? Q, sorry. And now this is the potential. And so if you look at the QP, so here you have something like that, okay? And if you are here, you have if you are here, you have something like that. You have open line. You have oscillation and liberation. Okay, if you are exactly at this energy, If you are exactly at this energy, you have some. If you are exactly at this energy, you have something like that. Huh? Yes, something like that. These two points coincide, of course. No? You are exactly like that. Allora, so, this is, let me call this H0. Okay. And so you have the motion like this and motion like this. Okay, now this is completely trivial. Now you introduce something here. Some function independent of q and t, periodically in time, periodic. Okay. So what happened? What happened is the following: that if you are far, you see that you have this particular trajectory, which is the which separate the rotation from liberation from oscillation. If you are here, you don't see nothing particular. If you are here, you don't see nothing particular. But if you are around this region, this is the result by Poincaré, this region is the region candidate to have chaos. And in addition, if you are able to do certain things, which is called Mannlia, it's possible to prove that this is true. Okay, this is difficult, but however, these are the regions which are candidate for the maybe you can show you the well, un po' capitolo il capitolo 11 deve essere no un po' più mi sembra che sia metti un po' homoclinic tipo. Metti Duffing, scrivi Duffing. Duffing. Sì. Poi vedi un po' più. No, un po' più là, forse. No, forse qua, forse qui. Ah, eccolo. Okay, this is not exactly the same. This is slightly different. This is the case where this p square plus here double l is something like q 4 minus p square. Okay, we have something like that. It's the same. Okay, here we have the same argument. So you see that this is the region of two minima. Okay, and you see that when you introduce the perturbation, you have that around the separatrix, you developed chaos. And this is possible to prove this stuff. Okay, this is one of the few exact results that you can have. And if you look carefully, even here you observe some regularity. We have this combination of chaos and regularity. And you say, why I discuss very quickly this story? Because this is an interesting application in geophysics. Because we have an interesting application in geophysics, because in geophysics you can have something like that, and this appear through a mechanism which is called off bifurcation. So when you change the control parameter in the fluid, you have that you have a transition from a stationary velocity field to with the superposition some periodicity, and so in a natural way, in the stream function appear a periodic part, and so. Then you can apply all these mechanisms in the problem of transport for example, contaminant in the ocean. So there are a lot of work in the study, the contaminant of pollutant due to this effect. And apparently this is surprising because this is a laminar flow, this is a laminar system. But laminar from the point of view looking at the field, but if you look at the particle, you see chaos. This is another idea by Arnold, the same Arnold before, and who remarked that, so since I have this equation, x dot equal u xt. So now we know that even if this vector field is smooth, simple, apparently simple, you can have a chaos, why not? No, but if you translate this in terms of fluid dynamics, apparently is a paradox because you have that a field, when you look at the field, is very smooth, very regular. Then when you put dust, dust performs a strange behavior, which apparently is a paradoxical situation. But if you look from the point of view of dynamical system, it's not paradoxical at all. This remark is due to Arnold many years ago. And actually, you can have that even very, very simple velocity field, just with sine, cosine, and so on, can produce an astonishingly complicated Lagrangian transport. This, for example, the people working in fluid dynamics, working in geophysics, the idea of Arnold was in 66 or something like that, and geophysics upset this idea at least 20 years later, maybe even 30. The some in Italy, very few geophysicists accept this idea, so because they refuse to enter in too mathematical tools. Okay, I guess I can stop here. Tomorrow we will have this written exam. Of course, it will be not on this part. So my suggestion, look at the maps, look at Perron-Frobenius, look at the ergodicity, so don't worry. The exam will not be too severe. Okay.
Okay. Thanks. Do you have questions?
So this last part, I understand, is a bit too dense, but just to give you an idea that dynamical system is not just a game of simple stuff. No, we can enter in real physics. Okay, this is just to mention that there are real applications, for example, in geophysics.
Okay, so thank you very much, Angelo. And,